The desire to be free from the limits of the human experience is as old as our first stories. We exist in an endless universe, only bound by the laws of physics, and yet our consciousness...
So just to like put it out there, because I am doing this video through the lens of like a tech founder now, so I just wanted to say that, you know, I did just drop out of a PhD in physics, so I can talk a little bit about physics, okay? So...
is trapped in mortal machine.
And he just said an endless universe. We don't know if it's endless, you know. It looks like it probably is, but at the same time, we don't know.
Beans made of meat. With the breathtaking explosion of innovation.
It was this song in the background, the Cyberpunk. They borrowed it from, it got sponsored, this video, I think, from Cyberpunk. So I think they've borrowed a song and it gets copyrighted.
And progress, for the first time, the concept of leaving our flesh piles behind and uploading our minds into a digital utopia.
You know what we'll do? We'll put it on times two then. We'll see if that still cops it. It might.
Yeah, seems possible. Even like the logical next step on our evolutionary ladder. Mind uploading and digital immortality are some of the core themes of the game Cyberpunk 2077. It plays in a grim dystopian future where humanity has progressed far beyond today's technology and explores what this could mean for humanity. About a year ago, CD Projekt Red asked if we would like to make a video about some of these ideas, and we were immediately on board. So, let's explore this topic together.
Is that meant to be Keanu Reeves?
Possible to upload your mind into a computer? Well, it's complicated. Upload what exactly? Mind is one of those words that are really hard to define. It's thought to be the collective abilities of your consciousness and intelligence, the thing that lets you imagine, recognize, and dream. Mind uploading is the hypothetical concept of making a copy of this inner world and transferring it into a computer to run a simulation of your consciousness. But even defining the premise gets really hard, really fast. The possibility of mind uploading is based on three assumptions. Assumption one, your mind is in your brain's structure, arrangement, and biochemistry. The idea that everything about the mind can be found in the brain is called physicalism, and it keeps our discussion within the domain of natural law. Assumption two, at some point, we will understand...
That's a big one. You know, we can't actually know that for sure, but we know nothing about consciousness, essentially. You know, that's not quite true, right? We're learning plenty about the brain, but it's still an absolute mystery how, you know, some electronic activity in the brains, you know, neuronal activity, and how that sort of forms a conscious experience. Like, what is going on there? And, you know, we go to sleep at night and it just disappears. You wake up in the morning and it's back. That is all a mystery, and that seems to be a large part of what consciousness is.
Brain well enough and possess the technology to simulate all of its aspects to make a digital mind copy. Assumption three, computer software can...
So, you know, with my take on physics, the physics take on this is basically, yeah, we might be able to solve what consciousness is through the lens of physics. I have no doubt that is probably the only way to solve what's going on here. You know, not the only way, as in, like, you'll need to, I think we're going to need to combine some physics, which is, you know, a lot of tricky math, as well as computational stuff. And a lot of stuff in physics nowadays is, you know, done computationally in terms of research. And then on the computational side, you might have seen things like ChatGPT and machine learning, right? You might think, oh, how's that related to physics? Well, if you went and looked at what machine learning is actually about, right, there's really complex mathematics deep in there. So it's just basically really complex statistics. And a lot of this stuff comes, by the way, of, you know, math and physics. So people think these are unrelated fields, but they're not, right? You'll find a lot of machine learning is being pushed in physics and those areas. And you might not know software was invented by physicists. The World Wide Web was invented by physicists. Like, you know, this is a... People just have no idea how interrelated these two fields tend to be. And I have no doubt that this could be some wacky combination of, you know, some fundamental physics principles combined with some computational thing. And it's going to maybe lead us to this new area of science.
Host your mind, which means the mind is computable. There is no physical property in the brain, including consciousness, that cannot be simulated accurately, even if it requires a lot of code. All of these assumptions have been proposed and challenged by scientists and philosophers, and they...
Scannability, we'll leave that one. This one is the one we can talk about right now. I will come back to computability because that is something I'm sure a lot of people out there don't have much idea of what I'm going to say, because this is, you know, we're almost, you know, tackling this one. Some would argue we do have some slight answers. So let's keep going and I'll pause in the future.
It remains the subject of passionate debate. With so many fundamental questions still unanswered, it's hard to discuss the topic without annoying someone. Whatever your position, every discussion of mind upload has to begin with the brain. The brain in a nutshell. The brain is the most complex biological structure known and deserves its own entire video, so let's just take a brief look at it. Around 100 billion neurons are communicating via 1 million billion connections that are sending signals up to 1,000 times each second, which is 1 quadrillion events every second of your waking life. And it's not just neurons, there are billions of supporting and immune cells of various types performing different jobs. On a macro level, the brain can be divided into several different roles, from breathing and heart rate to coordinating movement and involuntary reflexes. The most developed parts, the neocortex, or the outermost layer of the brain, hold memories, our ability to plan, think, and imagine, hope, and dream. Where exactly the you part?
If you didn't know, this whole outer layer is meant to be maybe what makes us human, because other animals don't seem to have it. But I know that's what we think makes us special. Like, maybe that's where the consciousness comes from, this outer layer. But anyway, let's keep going.
To the brain is situated is not entirely clear. We know that areas like the precuneus cortex have the greatest influence on our consciousness, but several areas can network together to share tasks none of them can do alone. The brain's building blocks are not exactly simple either. Neurons are not just wires, they alter and process information. Synapses, where signals are handed over from one neuron to the next, contain receptors for hundreds of chemical signals, opening them up to outside influence. We have a basic understanding of how these work, and we can accurately predict their behavior at small scales, but there's a lot more to the brain than just nerve signals. Hormones play a huge role, like serotonin, which affects our mood, or histamine, which helps us learn. The brain is influenced by our other parts too, from heart, nerves to gut bacteria. What seemed like a very complicated system to begin with gets even more complicated the more we learn about it. To get this wildly interconnected mess of cells and meat and chemicals into a computer, we need a model that we can simulate in our digital world. Some sort of...
Just another little interesting question for you guys. A lot of people in our world are suddenly convinced, by the way of psychology and neuroscience, that the chemistry happening up here, all which, you know, kind of exactly embody your emotions, you know, so they kind of think, at least it seems, like your emotions are your conscious experience, which are nothing more than the chemistry in your brain, okay? So if you mess with this chemistry, you can mess with emotions and things like that. But let me pose you a question here. Think about this. And I've asked this to neuroscientists, pharmacologists working in the neuro field, as well as medical doctors, okay? And they tell me that actually you're right, we don't, you know, that could be the case. So consider this, right? Are we nothing more than this brain chemistry, which are these emotions you experience? Or could there be something we're ignoring that sits above consciousness that we're just kind of ignoring, right? So imagine there's this consciousness thing above, yeah? And it takes in the data, like a function or a machine, and that consciousness thing, this bubble up here, then changes the chemistry or the emotions, which then... you know, is what we do. That's our behavior and feeling and things like that. Do you see what I'm saying? We're kind of just ignoring the fact that, not the fact, that the possibility that there could be this thing that sits above all this and dictates all of it, right? The way we kind of look at it is like this brain chemistry over here and these emotions. It's not just the environment, right? It's clearly also the brain chemistry, which is a product of biology and genes. So they kind of say, like, today, like, you know, your emotions and the things that go wrong are roughly like, you know, some part of the environment as well as some part of your biology. And that's us. However, everyone in these fields has no idea what the fuck a brain is doing to create consciousness. So we kind of just ignore consciousness as if it doesn't exist. But everyone knows, you know, what we think we know we're experiencing, right? So what if that big consciousness thing sits above and dictates? So what I'm suggesting is potentially everything that we are is coming from our environment. And actually, maybe we're not so much biology at all. Maybe the biology and the genes play a role in the brain chemistry. But maybe this consciousness thing is actually something a bit weirder in this universe, maybe, right? Like, maybe it's the same for most humans. Maybe we all share a very similar sentience thing. And that sits above and maybe dictates the brain chemistry. So your environmental signals, data, and then that consciousness thing then is the function which changes the brain chemistry. And I've posited this to people in these areas. And they actually, they're like, yeah, we just, that could be the case. We don't care. You know, we haven't got that far. We don't know what consciousness is. So come back when we can... and ask your question another day. So I just dropped out of my PhD to try and advance encryption standards around the world because quantum computers are right around the corner and it could be a big, big problem. So what I've done is taken my first step in trying to help. And so I've created a new kind of VPN. It's literally just with this advanced post-quantum cryptography, quantum safe cryptography. And here it is, my friends. So this is CalVPN. And if you want to come use it, you can get a 7-day free trial right now. I built this. And yeah, come support your boy. I made this. You can come get it at calvpn.com. It's on Mac and Windows. The Linux is about to come out, hopefully in a few days. And we're doing heaps of cool stuff. So please come check it out.
Computer, we need a model that we can simulate in our digital world. Some sort of scan. Unfortunately, our scanning technology, like fMRI machines, is not nearly good enough to attempt such a thing. But there is a different method that seems very promising. Cutting a brain into tiny slices and scanning them with a high-resolution electron microscope to create an accurate map of all the cells and connections. In 2019, scientists successfully mapped a cubic millimeter of mouse brain, roughly the size of a big grain of sand. It contained 100,000 neurons with a billion synapses and 4 kilometers of nerve fibers. This grain of brain was cut into 25,000 slices. 5 electron microscopes ran continuously for 5 months, collecting more than 100 million images. It took 3 months to assemble the images into a 3D model. The completed dataset fills up 2 million gigabytes of cloud storage. To scan a whole human brain, we would have to repeat this effort a million times, which is much easier said than done. Brain water to consciousness wine. While all of these issues are annoying, the real question is how we turn the static blueprint of the brain into an active thing. Even if we have a scan, down to the level of synapses, we need laws and rules that animate the wiring diagram. To endow this static structure with life, update it with the various laws of chemical bio of electrodynamics to animate the simulation. So it becomes a dynamic...
Electrodynamics. That is, you know, some complex physics there for you, right? You want to understand that stuff, you've got to go to postgrad physics. And, you know... when you remember everything is quantum fields, right? And trying to understand the brain from that point of view is just wild. Maybe we'll do it at the very end.
Thing like a brain that exists from 1 microsecond to the next, that can evolve in time, think, see, and act. The reality is that we just don't know if this is possible to achieve. If our technology can give rise to real minds. It all hinges on the nature of the problem. Are the brain and minds just complicated and a lot of work to figure out? Or are they complex in a way that we can't solve? In the worst case, consciousness is more than the sum of the parts of the brain in a way that we don't realize yet. Complex in a way that we can't solve by getting better scans. Just having a list of the ingredients might not be enough to get a good consciousness cake. Right now, we have a great starting point with tangible scientific results and an end goal, but the road to true simulation is unclear and requires a lot of innovation and research. Humans have historically been horrible at predicting the pace of progress. In the best case, it's just a matter of doing the work and finding the right solutions. It might not be necessary to simulate every last cell down to the last atom. Instead, it may be possible to simplify elements into probabilistic models that could match the behavior of the brain using a more manageable number of simpler systems. So we really don't know if we will ever understand our brain and consciousness well enough to upload human minds. But the science is real and worth pursuing. At the very least, we will just learn a lot about ourselves and develop a bunch of new technologies. If we succeed, this might put mind uploading well within the capabilities of our rapidly progressing computer technology. The consequences for humanity and our future in this universe are vast, creepy, and amazing.
So computability. Why is this so sort of such an interesting point of this sort of whole question? Well, you know, if you want to hear this explained again by a much smarter person... Nobel Prize winning physicist, mind you. You should go listen to Roger Penrose talk about this exact question. Roger thinks there's something in the brain which isn't computable. Some small part of consciousness, very small part, in which it's not computable because there's something there that is outside of logic. And what is computing things? It's basically running logic, right? You give some rules to a computer, and it runs through the logic, it checks it, right? And if there's errors, it'll stop. That's not explaining much of how computers work, but that's basically what they're doing. So in consciousness, if we would want to compute consciousness in a computer, you'd need to give invent some software that ran through logic. So if consciousness isn't computable because there are some truths you can't prove by the way of logic, we might not be able to simulate it. Now, it only might be one very small thing as well, like who knows, in consciousness that isn't computable, which means you just can't simulate it. So if you thought AI was going to take over everything, guess what? It might not be able to ever do what we do, because we actually might be special. I doubt it, but that could be the case.
The copy. Successful mind uploading is functional immortality.
If you want to read about that in much more depth, go check out Roger Penrose's book, The Emperor's New Mind, and he talks about very interesting things like intuitive math, intuitionist math, which is wild.
Less damaged or deleted, you will continue to exist as long as a copy is stored somewhere. Of course, if the scan is corrupted in any of a myriad of ways, your mind might get corrupted too. You might be in an eternity of pain or paranoia or having an endless psychotic breakdown. The question if this digital mind is you opens another whole can of worms. For now, we'll just assume that your digital mind at least feels like it's you. How would mind uploading change your outlook on life? Will you feel safer knowing that death is not necessarily the end? Or would you try to be super safe to avoid dying before your mind is uploaded? If scanning technology does become advanced enough, your biological and digital versions could coexist. You could help each other out by making your biological lifespan more enjoyable and the future of the copy more secure. Whatever happens, your mind copy will begin a completely new life once it opens their digital eyes for the first time. Having a functional body is actually quite nice, and you're pretty used to it. Food, love, pain, and exhaustion, all of these things are parts of us that we must live with. But in the end, they are the result of neurons firing in your brain. So while you could decide to live in a simulated body, it might be optional
for... Who knows what we really are, right? Because all of reality is being hallucinated in this little piece of meat. And what you see, what you hear, what you feel, it's not reality. It's your brain's interpretation of whatever this is. People don't appreciate this enough. Like sound, it's not really there. What's really there is atoms and pressure waves. and your brain converts this motion of particles into something in your brain, which isn't actually there. I'm scaring you? Sorry. So now the Neuralink discussion. A little more, and then we'll talk about it.
Digital mind. Falling in love might lose meaning if you can have it at the press of a button. Instead, you might end up searching for new extraordinary experiences. Walk on the surface of the sun. Speed up time to skip past a few boring lumps. Experience a simulation of the past. Your perspective.
All of these things are, you know, immensely complicated. Like, what is time? Wow. Like, well, you know, what's time in the brain? What's time in objective reality?
And priorities will change as you continue to exist in this liberated form. The longer digital minds exist, eventually they will likely gain greater knowledge of themselves and an ability to change their own context. This can be as simple as deleting a memory that bugs you. You might change aspects of your personality, like grudges, addictions, or laziness. Without the constraints of biology, your abilities might move up as technology progresses, while your priorities or goals might become more and more foreign to your original brain if it's still alive. Waking up to the true potential of digital immortality will be gradual. You can start projects that would take more than a lifetime to complete. Scientists could accumulate an incredible amount of knowledge, leading to discoveries that could revolutionize the world. Adventurers could upload themselves onto small spaceships and embark on journeys to the stars, just putting themselves on pause for thousands of years at a time. Although it's unlikely that every digital mind will work for the benefit of humanity.
The Neuralink is right on our front door, and they're trying to put chips in human brains, right? They just started human trials. Is it this year or later next year? You know, they're trying to attack very awesome things to begin with, like helping people who have severe disabilities, who are paralyzed, right? And re-stimulating parts that give you access to movement again. And I think what they're doing is phenomenal. You know, with what Neuralink is doing, it really looks like they're going to be able to give back people this sort of access to motion. And I really think it might work out. And there's a lot of, I've read a lot of people in you know, neurologists, neuroscientists who push back on what Neuralink is doing. And they think it is actually just a load of bullshit half the time. We need to allow scientists to, I don't know, keep speculating freely. There's been a lot of pushback of that in recent years. You know, if we don't allow free speech, how does science ever progress? If we don't allow people to question the things we currently think, it's like no one actually thinks anymore, right? It's everyone's just so brainwashed in our world to thinking, you know, we can't allow misinformation. But if we do that, it's like these people don't realize all sort of new ideas a lot of the time is always necessarily, whenever it's first proposed, misinformation. Has no one realized this? You know, how do we ever come up with new ideas in theoretical physics that question everything that come before or whatever? Maybe someone comes along and says, hey, the way you're thinking about the brain and psychology, it's all wrong. We need to go with this approach. And this is probably going to happen, right? Just look at the history of physics, which has given us our world. Right, all of our technological world is thanks to physics. If you don't understand that, you need to go learn some physics. But just look at, say, Einstein, right? When Einstein came around in about early 20th century, he had his miracle year in, 1905. And he basically came along and said, hey, the ether is not real. And the way you're thinking about light is straight up wrong. And these were major things in physics. And everyone sort of did believe in the ether, as well as, you know, the universe being this stagnant thing in which, you know, nothing changed. It was eternal. Along comes Einstein, goes, you're all wrong. Everything is wrong. The speed of light travels at a constant speed for everyone, no matter what reference frame you're in. Otherwise, reality doesn't work. And all this other wild shit. And everyone, and the ether doesn't exist. There's actually something called space-time, right? That's what light is propagating through. And no one, there was huge pushback. Everyone thought he was a fraud. No one wanted to listen to him. Okay, so do you see Einstein, the pinnacle of what we think of science, everything he put forward initially was considered misinformation. Okay, so be careful when someone, you know, suggests some new idea that does go against the status quo and sort of, and just straight away touting it as misinformation. If we keep doing that, advancement dies, and our society, by proxy, dies. Is that not a problem? I think Neuralink is going to... I think it'll keep progressing, and I hope it achieves some of the things it's aiming to, because it would be marvelous and wonderful for society, and it would help people suffer less. And then, to dream a little bit, it could be amazing at, you know, the doors it unlocks for us. You know, imagine, you know, dreaming awake and creating like this little virtual reality in your, all in your head. and kind of just manipulating whatever you're doing currently, which is hallucinating reality. Why isn't it possible? We're all walking around hallucinating what we think we see. Why couldn't we manipulate that? Anyway, that's all I have to say about that.